Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In our second reading today, Colossians 1:6, Paul writes, "The gospel is bearing fruit and growing throughout the whole world, just as it has been doing among you since the day you heard it and truly understood God's grace." In other words, the gospel of Jesus Christ is not something you just hear, you believe, you get saved, and that's the end of it. Paul says the gospel of Jesus Christ is meant to take root in us like a seed, and then continue to grow and grow inside us like a tree until it bears life-sustaining fruit. And what are the three essential fruits that we need to have a healthy spiritual life? It's like cereal commercial. What are the three essential fruits that we need? Time and time again, Scripture shows us it's faith, hope, and love. Those are the three essential fruits for a healthy spiritual life. These are the supporting pillars that hold up everything else we have, everything else we do as Christians. Faith, hope, and love. So let's look at our second reading, Colossians 1, 3-5. "We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, because we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love you have for all God's people, the faith and love that spring from the hope stored up for you in heaven, about which you have already heard in the true message of the gospel that has come to you." Again, faith, hope, and love are the three pillars of the Christian life. They're like three pistons in an engine that make the whole vehicle move. And if one of those pistons isn't firing right, it's not working right, the car's not going to go very far. It's going to limp along. It's the same way in our spiritual life. We need faith, hope, and love all working together to get our faith, to get our life moving, our Christian life moving. Faith is what connects us with Jesus in the first place. It's through faith that we know that God loves us, so that God made us with a special purpose in life. It's through faith that we know that Jesus died on the cross for our sins, so that if we believe in him, we can have forgiveness of sins and eternal life in his name. Faith is what connects us with the life of Jesus. Hope, though, is what gives our life in Jesus direction. Because hope is what helps us to keep our eyes on the prize that's waiting for us at the end of our earthly lives, eternal life with Jesus in heaven. Hope is what helps us to stay strong when we go through those hard times, because we know that these trials are not the end of the story. Because of hope, Paul could write in Romans chapter 8, verse 18, "I consider that our present sufferings are not worthy to be compared with the glory that will be revealed in us." In other words, hope is what warms us, and it gives us light when we go through those dark nights of the soul. So faith connects us with the life of Jesus. Hope gives direction to our life with Jesus. And that brings us to the third pillar, the third piston in the engine. Now that I'm a forgiven child of God, on my way to an eternity with Jesus in heaven, how then shall we live here in this world, in this life? We are called by Jesus as Christians to love. Love gives purpose to our life with Jesus. So faith connects us with the life of Jesus. Hope gives direction to our life with Jesus. Love gives purpose to our life with Jesus. Now, who are we called to love? That's the question. Love is kind of abstract. Who are we called to love? Let's look now at our gospel reading. Luke chapter 10, verses 25-28. You can follow along with me in the bulletin. "On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. 'Teacher,' he asked, 'what must I do to inherit eternal life?' 'What is written in the law?' he replied. 'How do you read it?' He answered, 'Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself.' 'You have answered correctly,' Jesus replied. 'Do this, and you will live.'" Jesus says that as Christians, we now have two spheres of responsibility. We have a responsibility towards God, to love him, all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. We have a responsibility toward our neighbors, to love them as ourselves. Now, loving God is pretty self-explanatory. We talk about that a lot in church. How do you love God? You shall have no other gods. Right? You shall remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. You shall honor and worship Jesus as the way, the truth, and the life, because no one comes to the Father except through him. It's pretty clear-cut how we are to love God. How do you love your neighbor? Who exactly is our neighbor? This is where things can get a little bit hazy. And this is why sometimes different Christians have different callings to serve different people. I'll show you what I mean in a minute. But first, let's look at our gospel reading again, verse 29 on to the end. Let's read that together. Verse 29 to the end of the gospel reading. But he, the expert in the law, wanted to justify himself. So he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, he passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have.' Now, which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell in the hands of robbers?" The expert in the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "You go and do likewise." So who is our neighbor? And how do we fulfill our Christian responsibility to love our neighbor as ourselves? Again, this is not so clear cut. And again, this is why sometimes different Christians have different callings to serve different people. And this is why I've been struggling all week with the focus of today's message. You see, there's been a lot of pressure this week on EOCA pastors, of which I'm one, coming from progressive social justice circles for us to tell you who your neighbor is this week. Your neighbor, they want me to tell you, is Philando Castile, who is yet another black man who was shot dead this past week by white cops for seemingly no other reason than he was black and they were scared. Philando Castile, they want me to say, was attacked by robbers on the way to Jericho who robbed him of his life. And meanwhile, we as privileged white people, they want me to tell you, we're like the priest and the Levite who walk past and keep going our own way unconcerned as more and more people of color are victimized by bad apples and law enforcement. All right. Philando Castile is our neighbor who was attacked unjustly. And minorities in our country do need our love, our prayers, our support, and our advocacy against police violence. But then an interesting yet sad thing happened. The very next day, as you know, another terrible, tragic event happened in Dallas, Texas. This time the tables were turned, and now a black shooter shoots 5 white police officers for no other reason than apparently they were white and they were police officers. So now we have these conservative groups putting pressure on us pastors to tell you who your neighbor is today. And they want me to tell you that our neighbor are the 5 officers who were unjustly murdered. Lauren Abrams, Michael Cole, Michael Smith, Brett Thompson, and Patrick Zamorica. They were the ones attacked by a robber on the road to Jericho who robbed them of their life. And meanwhile, as complacent, unconcerned citizens, we're like the priest and the Levite who walk past, keep going our own way as more and more law enforcement officers die every day in the line of duty. And you know what? They're right too. The police officer is our neighbor. And law enforcement people need our love and our prayers and our support. So as a Christian, who should I make the focus of today's message about? But there's more. Because the Hispanic community wants me to tell you that our neighbor is the immigrant who's new to this country and they're struggling to make an honest living and they're working hard 80 hours a week, that they're being robbed of equal opportunity because of prejudice, because they look and sound different and don't speak the same language we do. And you know what? They're right too. The immigrant is our neighbor, and they need our love and support. And then there's those with an international focus who want me to tell you that our neighbor is the refugee from war-torn Syria. He's our neighbor. She is our neighbor. They need our love and support. And they're right. And those who think that charity should start at home here in Pahrump, you know what they would want me to tell you today? They would want me to tell you today that our neighbor is the homeless vet who lives in the desert, who lives behind Walmart. They are the forgotten ones. They are the ones abandoned on the side of the road. They are the ones who need our love and support. back to. Members of our church who are homebound or in the hospital for long periods of time or living in a nursing home who don't get many visitors, they would want me to tell you that they are the neighbor who's been abandoned, who's alone, and sitting ignored on the side of the road. And they're right. There are so many competing voices out there trying to get our attention, telling us, this person is your neighbor, I'm your neighbor, this person's been forgotten, I've been forgotten, I need your help. So what does this tell us? This tells us there's a lot of hurting people out there on the road to Jericho. There is a lot of neighbors out there. We have a lot of neighbors out there who need us, who need our love, who need our help. So who is our neighbor? Our neighbor is anyone and everyone who's alone and hurting, whom God has brought into your life, who needs to receive the love of Jesus in a practical way. They need to receive the love of Jesus in a practical way. That's compassion. Look at verses 33 to 35 of the Gospel. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, and then he put the man on his own donkey, he brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. The kind of love that Jesus is calling us to love our neighbor, is a practical, compassionate kind of love. It doesn't just feel sorry for our neighbor. It's a love that does something for our neighbor so we can at least make their burden a little bit lighter. But of course, wisdom comes in knowing which neighbor God has called me to serve and show compassion to today. Because again, sometimes different Christians, different callings, serve different people. And again, there's not just one wounded man on the road to Jericho, there's thousands. There's millions out there who can't possibly care for all the wounded that God has brought into our lives. The danger is that we start to feel overwhelmed and desensitized and detached, and we end up not doing anything at all. So my advice, pray about it. Pray about it and ask God to show you one wounded man, one wounded woman in your life who's lying on the road to Jericho all alone. Everyone else has just walked by. Let God show you one man, one woman. Maybe it's someone you know who's homebound or in a nursing home that could really use a visit this week. Be a neighbor. Or maybe it's a homeless vet that you drive past every day on the way to Walmart that could really use a bottle of water. Be a neighbor. Maybe it's an immigrant that you see selling food on the side of the road and they really need that sale to help provide for their family. Buy a bag of apples from them. Maybe it's a widower, you know, who's still grieving and really is a hug or a phone call. Be a neighbor. Find that one woman, that one wounded man or woman, and pray, Jesus, give me compassion for that person. And help me to show them your love in a practical way, just as you showed your love to me in a practical way. Dying on the cross for my sins when I was wounded. Enlarge my heart with the power of the Holy Spirit and help me to serve that person. And when we're doing that, all three pistons of our engine are working smoothly. Faith, hope, and love. And then we'll know without a doubt that the gospel of Jesus Christ has taken root in our lives and that the Spirit is now bearing fruit in us. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I fail in this so much. I am so weak in love. Help all of us. Help me to love our neighbor as ourselves. Give us the eyes of Christ. Help us to have your heart. Help us to be your hands and your feet. Help us not just to walk by and be that priest or the Levite who just walks by because we're overwhelmed or we're busy or going somewhere else. Help us feel compassion and to do something for the people in our lives that need that help. A neighbor is a neighbor no matter how small. Give us eyes that can see the pain around us, a heart that's willing to do something. We pray these things in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. Amen.